Hello and welcome to P Guru's channel. I'm your host, Sri Iyer. I'm here with Sri Satish Sharma. Sri Satish Sharma is responsible for VHS United Kingdom, and he's been involved intimately in subjects that affect Hindus, Hinduism in general, and he has been a pioneer of some causes. And in fact, we're going to talk today about one of those causes, Hindu odium. Satishji, what is Hindu odium and how did you come about terming this phrase?
Good morning and thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to the wider VHS community. Like most Hindu communities, the British Hindu community, which numbers about probably under 900,000 here in the UK, mm-hmm. we've been a very quiet and busy community. We've established ourselves in a manner which has earned us respect and appreciation from the host community.
Right.
And the statistics bear out that our contribution is recognized and accepted. But a strange thing occurred in 2013, mm-hmm. and that was that a member of the House of Lords stood up and made a speech, and in that speech we were vilified and denigrated at a level and in a manner that just made us pause in our tracks and think, hang on a minute, what's going on here? And so the issue that he raised was that he accused the British Hindu community of being caste supremacists.
Hmm.
In essence, he put forward the notion that there were 480,000 people in this country who were on the receiving end of discriminatory practices from the dominant host Hindu community.
I see, it's one in two almost.
One in two, quite literally. And I actually put it forward to him when I responded that this means that in our temples,
mm-hmm.
half of all of our mothers
mm-hmm.
are acting in a racist, discriminatory manner.
Mm.
Or half of our doctors, half of our children, half of our sons and daughters. You're saying that half of the Hindu accountants and the doctors and the lawyers, they are all acting in this manner.
Mm.
And this is a complete and utter nonsense. It was a total fabrication. But what became evident
mm-hmm.
was that it was the beginning of a campaign.
Mm.
And the campaign seemed to have been directed at generating unpleasantness, at creating an air of distrust, of creating an air of criticism and hostility towards the Hindu community.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the phrase that is most often used is phobia.
Mm.
So if you want to refer to people
right.
who have an irrational fear of something,
right.
They call it a phobia.
Mm.
Islamophobia is a very commonly used
right.
word now.
Right.
But the equivalent doesn't exist with regard to Hindus,
mm-hmm.
because I have yet to come across a group of people who think of Hindus and go, oh my God, we're fearful of Hindus.
Yes.
You know, it's just not
a
reality. And as a community, we are not a community who instill fear
mm-hmm.
in other communities. We're not fearsome people by tradition. And so that word Hindu phobia wasn't really appropriate. And so I thought we needed something which was more precise
mm-hmm.
and described the phenomenon with greater clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And so odium is a Latin word,
mm-hmm.
and it means essentially to have an irrational hatred
mm-hmm.
towards something
mm-hmm.
without having any reason to.
Mm-hmm.
It's just purely and solely
mm-hmm.
hatred of something.
Mm-hmm.
And it struck me that what was being created was an air of Hindu odium.
Mm-hmm.
So an air of critical, demeaning, of vilifying,
mm-hmm.
without reasons,
mm-hmm.
but just to create that air.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we explored the evidence, it became clear that there was no evidence to justify
mm-hmm.
the remarks that he had made.
Mm-hmm.
And it was purely an exercise in creating Hindu odium.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have decided to label the beast by its nature.
Casting back on our heritage and culture, which goes back thousands of years. Now, in putting together the response to Lord Harry's observations and moving forward, it appears that you've done a lot of research, looked into Hindu texts to find out the real meaning, also as to when this word caste, which is probably not a word that has an equivalent in Hinduism, except maybe jati. But to me, jati was sort of a word that got derived from the word vijnani. Vijnani over the time became gyani, and gyani, as it gets spread around the country, became jati. Essentially, it meant an expert in a certain field. And how did that get transported into caste? And maybe you can let our viewers know about how this thing came about. The British, after all, ruled us for 200 plus years.
Yes.
So maybe you can expand on that.
That'd be a wonderful thing. I'd really like to take the opportunity to set the record straight, because it hasn't been addressed. And it's now become almost a part of the common consciousness of the world that to be Indian is to have a caste. And you will find many Indian scholars have also accepted this as an assumed truth without feeling the need to investigate it.
Right.
Now, this notion that this is an assumed truth was actually at the heart of Lord Harris's little enterprise. He assumed that because everybody already knows that Hindus have a caste problem, nobody will look at it, and nobody will inspect it, and on a wave of passionate oratory, he managed to carry the word into legislation. Parliament didn't even feel we need to scrutinize the evidence that was presented to them. And the evidence that was presented to them was deeply flawed in itself. But because it was an assumed truth, they then went and it's actually been put onto the statute books that it's now a crime to discriminate against a person on the basis of caste. Now, the discrimination aspect, we don't have any issue with at all. But our lived experience here in the UK is that caste does not feature as a part of the daily life of the Indian, Sikh and Jain communities.
Right.
And so when he spoke about so passionately about this being a terrible blight on the British citizenry, we first went back into our own communities. And as you know, I work with the Hindu temples in this country. And we have never had an issue where somebody has gone into a temple and said, oh, I've been discriminated against on the basis of my caste. It doesn't happen. You know, we have Diwalis, we have Holis, and there is just no identification. It is a purely, totally anonymous event where everyone comes together and participates, as we always do. So it was completely absent. It was completely absent from the landscape of our daily life. So I thought, well, why on earth has this been done? And how are we going to respond to this? And the response needed to be in a manner which was going to withstand scrutiny. And so I thought the only way to respond to this is to understand how this phenomenon appeared. When, why, what were the social circumstances? And it needed to be definitive. From a Shastric point of view, I knew that the culture that gave birth to Ayurveda, to yoga, to the Ekam Satvipra Bahudha Vadanti, all of these Vasudeva Kutumbakam, it has a vision of all of humanity as being connected by a shared divinity. And so when you have that as the ethos, how on earth does that suddenly transfer itself into a social structure which is based on a hierarchical belief that some people are superior to others? It doesn't fit. So I went back to the historical books and to the earliest, truest versions of the Shastras that I could locate. And you are absolutely right to identify this notion of jati. I would add to it that we have a concept of varna. And those two are terms which are used according to the capacity to inflict harm upon us interchangeably.
Whichever is convenient.
Caste is one of those words which has now acquired its own life. And it's become a trigger word that can be used anytime you want to denigrate or demean or diminish a Hindu or an Indian. You mention the word caste and suddenly it has that impact. People respond to it without actually having a clear understanding of what that word means. You don't need to know, because you already know. It's that sort of reaction. And so I thought we need to dissect this and understand it so there is complete clarity. What was its genesis? How was it introduced? Did it have any political machinations behind it? All of those things we decided we needed to know. And on that journey, I learned a huge amount and uncovered many things which I was completely unaware of, like most of our community. And some of those things are that caste as a word reflects a concept which is defined in law as being a way in which a society organizes itself, which is hierarchical,
mm-hmm.
it is hereditary,
mm-hmm.
and it is endogamous.
Mm-hmm.
So you are born into your strata,
right.
you marry within your strata,
mm-hmm.
and the various stratas, they have some sort of superior, inferior designation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That is the precise definition of what caste means. That's the concept. The word caste is a European word.
Mm-hmm.
It's from a Portuguese word, which means class. And in Portugal, at the time, in medieval times,
mm-hmm.
they had a hierarchical,
mm-hmm.
hereditary,
mm-hmm.
endogamous social structure.
Okay.
So you had your servants, your serfs, your peasantry,
mm-hmm.
you had your landholding gentry,
mm-hmm.
you had your royal families,
mm-hmm.
you also had your priests,
mm-hmm.
and the popes and mm-hmm. bishops and so
mm-hmm.
on.
Mm-hmm.
And there were ceilings in between them.
Mm-hmm.
And to this day, or when one of the British royal family got married,
mm-hmm.
He married a commoner.
Yes.
Okay, and it's a common parlance, but
mm-hmm.
the ideology behind it was that she wasn't of the royal group of families.
Mm-hmm.
She wasn't of blue blood. And so in Europe they had a caste system. In Britain they had a caste system.
They exported it into India.
And then what happened was that the term was applied.
Mm-hmm.
They identified that there are priests, there are kings, there are merchants, and there are peasants. Guys, we know this, we have this in Europe,
mm-hmm.
and so this is the same system.
Mm-hmm.
But what they didn't find convenient
mm-hmm.
was that there was fluidity
mm-hmm.
between the various groupings. There was no birth-related prescription that if you were born into a Kshatriya family, you would be a Kshatriya. It wasn't constructed in that manner at all. We had fluidity between
mm-hmm.
all of
mm-hmm.
those things.
Mm-hmm.
So they chose that word and applied it to the Indian system, but then the British decided to make use of this word to manipulate the manner in which the society functioned and the manner in which the society perceived itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have identified certain authors who are non-Indian,
mm-hmm.
they are Occidental
mm-hmm.
Scholars, and they have also recognized
mm-hmm.
that prior to colonial times, the fluidity between the various jatis
mm-hmm.
was an intrinsic part of Indian social life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this is borne out by the evidence that we have. We have rishis who were born into what would be called lower castes.
Exactly.
And
right.
yet they aspired and became recognized
mm-hmm.
as Brahm rishis.
Right.
You know, Valmikiji himself is a
right.
great example of
mm-hmm.
this, and Vedvyasa is a great mm-hmm. example. So the reality of the time and the reality of as it is stored in our history reflects fluidity.
Mm-hmm.
So there was no rigidity in these strata.
Mm-hmm.
When the British came along, they viewed India as a resource pool,
mm-hmm.
not just physical and mineral resources, but also the workforce was
right.
viewed as a resource pool.
Right.
And in 1911, a census was being conducted
mm-hmm.
by the British,
mm-hmm.
and this was not for the benefit of the nation. This was to allocate and identify attributes and resources so they could be marshalled
mm-hmm.
to support the British Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And so in 1911...
Also became a template for divide and rule, probably.
Well, divide and rule was a fundamental principle that you can see at work
mm-hmm.
in almost everything the British did at that
mm-hmm.
time there.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many quotations. Lord Elphinstone,
mm-hmm.
I mentioned, who decided to implement that as a deliberate policy of the British colonial Raj.
Mm-hmm.
He declared in Parliament that our motto should be divide and rule. It worked for the Romans and it will work for us in
yes.
India.
Mm.
So that was very, very much an intrinsic part of it. But there was a British administrator called Middleton
mm-hmm.
who was conducting the 1911 census.
Mm-hmm.
And in his notes for that census, he writes very clearly that where we couldn't identify the caste
mm-hmm.
of a person or their occupation,
mm-hmm.
we just shoehorned them
mm.
into one of the four categories.
I see.
Okay.
Mm.
So at a stroke, 1,500 jatis
mm.
were suddenly all shoehorned
mm-hmm.
into one Shudra class.
Mm.
Okay. And he also writes that the caste system,
mm.
which we acknowledge has a devastating effect on
mm.
social order,
mm-hmm.
is something we abhor but we are largely responsible for the system that we abhor. Okay, so he clearly accepted that this was the outcome of their manipulation.
So just to get a perspective of the timeline, by 1911, this new system had deeply set roots in India.
It took about 40 years, because they did censuses every decade. It took about 40 years. The first time they went into the villages and they were asking people, what's your caste?
Mm-hmm.
People didn't understand what they were talking about.
Right.
But 40 years later, everybody up and down the country had been labeled and allocated, categorized, and slotted into this hierarchical, endogamous, hereditary system, which was actually a figment of their creation. And my research has uncovered even more striking things. There was an administrator called Wisley who was sent, and he decided that the superiority and inferiority of races could be determined by the bridge of a nose.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
This was a new
science called phrenology that the Victorians created. And that the closer you were to a European nose, the more elevated and evolved you were.
Oh, wow.
And the flatter your nose, the more inferior you were.
I see.
And so they also had that as a perspective for categorizing the regional differences in forms and saying, well, okay, everybody who's like us is higher, and the Aryans obviously polluted the gene pool, and so we can trace their superiority.
Mm-hmm.
It was a complete body of study and research and science which had a high degree of acceptance, even though it was complete and utter nonsense.
Well, they had the backing of the government, and they were entrusted to driving this message down.
They did.
And
they did it so successfully. So by the time 1911 occurred, they had pretty much shoehorned everybody into various castes. So the concept of caste, and that the notion to be an Indian is to have a caste, was an achievement of the British colonial organizers and administrators. Prior to it, there was no hereditary, hierarchical, endogamous social structure. So we clearly establish that caste as a part of Indian identity was a fabrication of the British colonial rule. The other thing I wanted to identify was Dalits, this untouchable class, as they were identified by the British and labeled by the British. Where did they come from? You know, I've read many historical records of Chinese visitors to India, of visitors from Arabia, and they wax lyrical. They speak at length about the beauty and the elevated status of the sciences that are present in this country. You know, India was the university to the world.
Right.
And nowhere do they mention the existence of an untouchable class.
Right, right.
So I wanted to know exactly where this occurred. And this was my biggest surprise, in fact. I identified that in 1871, the British Parliament passed an act called the Criminal Tribes Act. Now, the British had a tendency of trying to make a percentage on every transaction that was occurring in the whole nation. And the more times they could take that percentage, the happier they were. So I'll give you one example. In olden times in India, goods were transferred from one city or a town to another city or a town, and they were taken by families who had an ancestral occupation of being couriers. And they were entrusted with goods. They held their reputation in the highest regard.
Yes.
So a merchant could happily entrust goods to them, and they would take those goods and deliver them to a neighboring town. So they had an ancestral jati, an occupational grouping, and they had occupations. They managed to sustain themselves and thrive. Now the British decided that they wanted to tax the movement of goods. And to do that, they needed an instrument. The instrument that they chose was the 1871 Criminal Tribes Act. And that gave them authority to designate a group of people as being criminals by birth. One of the architects of that particular act, he said that in the same way that other traditions have a hereditary aspect to them, there are also groups who are criminal by birth. They are destined to remain criminals by birth and will continue to be criminals until they are exterminated.
Oh my God.
Okay. And what they used this legislation for was to designate a group of people as a criminal by birth tribe. And they designated those who were responsible for the movement of goods as a criminal tribe.
I see.
And that enabled them. What they then did is they created what I've referred to in my report as concentration camps.
Mm.
They created small enclaves associated to the nearest village or the nearest town, and a criminal tribe were required to get a pass to move from one location to another location.
Oh my God.
Their movement was restricted. It was publicized that they were thieves by birth. And so they had absolutely no means of sustenance anymore.
Mm.
And they tumbled in terms of their capacity to sustain their communities to such a level that they had to resort to doing the most menial tasks, because that's the only avenue that they had left to derive some sort of income. And so they became the ones who were clearing the carcasses, and they became the tanners as they were working with carcasses. They became the garbage disposal workers, and they were denigrated, vilified, and humiliated as a policy of the British at that time. And every other community was encouraged to note that these were criminal tribes by birth. To give you an example of how horrific this was, in Bengal, there were 273 tribes just classified as criminal by birth by the tick of an administrator's, a legislator's pen. And over a period of 80 years, the Dalit untouchable class came into existence.
I see.
It's a horrific piece of history. But to give you an idea of how recent this is, I came across statistical records that in 1947, when India gained independence, there were 13 million people scattered around India who were all designated as criminals by birth by that legislation. So this is not long ago. And so this is the genesis. The report presents the discovery that this is the genesis of the Dalit untouchable class.
I see.
So they were created by a legal implement of the British administration.
You know, I have a fundamental problem with the assumption that the caste system is alive and thriving in a country like England, because I thought people migrated to England based on their meritocracy, based on what they had. They either had aspirations that they felt could be best met by this country. They came here as students, probably, or they came here as probably merchants or something like that. But so how did the diaspora suddenly get qualified into something that they probably don't even realize it, because they've been away from their homes for a long time. They've put down roots in this country. And if anything, they would have probably gotten even less conscious of what their beginnings were.
I think that's a very valid observation, and it holds true. If you consider, I would suggest that the reason caste has become such a feature of life in India is because it's enshrined in law and it's enshrined in government. Now, we saw that if this legislation comes onto the statute box, then what will happen is that in the same way in which public bodies such as hospitals and schools, they monitor that discrimination doesn't occur on the basis of gender, on the basis of race, on the basis of ethnicity or religious belief. But they would then also start to monitor that discrimination is not occurring on the basis of caste. They'd be required to.
To start recording that stuff.
To start recording it. And once something becomes embedded into the administrative processes of a nation, then the people will adjust themselves to work in that system.
Oh boy.
So we saw a future in which schools would be noting the caste of children. And so that means children would be going to school and recognizing and accepting the reality that caste existed. Whereas our approach and attitude is to say, well, this is something that needs to be erased from consciousness in its entirety.
Exactly.
Whereas enshrining it into law creates. And to do so under the aegis of equality legislation is an incredibly devious act. And I don't think it's accidental.
So as a population, as a percentage, what would be the percentage of Indo-British in England?
It's just under 2%.
Just under 2%.
Yeah.
And I have one other question going back to the 1870s, but let me first finish this line of thought and then we'll just jump back to that. So even assuming that, you know, these recordings start happening, it seems to me this is more an effort to divide this prosperous ethnic community that has come to the United Kingdom, when India itself is trying to distance itself from this concept. It's recognizing that it was Varna, where you became what you practiced in profession. So I consider myself as a Kshatriya, because I'm essentially fighting wars on different fronts through my pen and my mouth, I guess. you know, so regardless of where you're born, the profession defines who you are. So, what do you see as a reason for this effort?
Well, let's go back to the basics. In this country, remember a few years ago, David Cameron declared that England is a Christian nation.
The identity of the country.
The identity of the country.
Right.
And I think it's noteworthy that when David Cameron declared that, Indians didn't stand up in horror and say, No. England is becoming a Christian national country. But the moment somebody in India says, well, actually, our identity is Hindu, all of the Western media suddenly rises up in a clamor and says, no, it's a Hindu nationalist country and it's a terrible
thing.
Exactly. There is a mismatch in terms of approach here. But here in the UK, we have just under 2%. And that's about 900,000 as a population. It's accepted that we contribute in the region of 2% of the population, 6% to GDP, which is a really significant contribution.
Wow.
By extension, that would mean that if everybody contributed in the same manner, we would have almost a 300% growth of GDP in this country. And we have another statistic I uncovered is we have the second lowest representation in the prison population. We have less than 500 people from the Indian Hindu Dharmic community in prisons. So we have a very positive profile. And I think the community has gotten to that stage where we're busy in economic activity, which receives the approval of the powers that be. They want us to be busy contributing to the exchequer and participating in the life of the country. But we are now getting to the stage where our manners, our way of working, our understanding of spirituality, all of those are beginning to influence the domestic community. One in eight workers in the City of London is of Indian origin.
I see.
Okay, so we are now at the stage where we have two ministers who are from Indian backgrounds. And I suspect, I wouldn't be surprised if there were people who perceived this as a threat and then decided that actually we need to have not so much unity. This community is becoming united, is becoming coherent, is becoming supportive of itself, and its footprint is now being felt in the nation. Wouldn't it be nice to make them a little bit weaker? Now, perhaps I'm being cynical, but I grew up in a Church of England school, so I know a little bit about the Bible, and there's one phrase in Timothy where the description of how to judge a person is given, by their works shall you know them. And so if we look at the works of the religious establishment in this country and use that to try and judge and understand them, it's consistent with my cynical understanding that the domestic community was perceived to be possibly a religious threat, a threat to the religious identity of this country. And it's not, I don't feel, a coincidence that the person who started this piece of legislation is a retired bishop of Oxford. He has been a very prominent and active member of the evangelical movement in India. He has spent time in India and is committed to spreading the notion that Christianity has a superiority over other dharmic and indigenous traditions. All of those are consistent with the manner in which he introduced this legislation. If you then take into account that the evidence that he supported this legislation with was deeply, deeply flawed, it does not stand up to scrutiny. It's a terrible piece of research, so much so that the managing director of the organization which produced that research is on record as saying this was never intended to support legislation. Mm. It doesn't have sufficient integrity nor quality.
Mm-hmm.
It was merely an anecdotal document that we had put forward.
Mm.
And the evidence is certainly not worthy of supporting legislation.
So has it been made into law now?
This is another remarkable event in that when we saw this piece of legislation introduced in the House of Lords,
mm-hmm.
We were horrified at the accusations that mm-hmm. were being levelled at us. Remember, legislation in the UK applies to the UK,
mm-hmm.
and there was talk of dowry grabbing, of female feticide,
mm-hmm.
all of the unpleasantness possibly be dumped onto the Hindu community was dumped there in the floor of the House of Lords. In fact, much of what was said, if it had been said outside of Parliament,
mm-hmm.
it would have been deemed illegal.
Mm.
It would have fallen foul of hate speech.
Mm.
But because it was protected by parliamentary privilege,
mm-hmm.
they articulated the most horrific views.
And there was nobody to defend their side.
And there was no one to defend.
Mm.
It was almost like the culmination
mm-hmm.
of a long-range programming of a marketing activity
mm-hmm.
where you denigrate something in the background to such a degree
mm-hmm.
that everybody assumes that it's a truth
mm.
and they don't scrutinize it. There was a time, and again, this is a little piece from history, there used to be the role of somebody called the Witchfinder General in
mm-hmm.
this country,
mm-hmm.
and he used to travel up and down the country and
mm-hmm.
identify witches.
I see.
Okay. And it was common practice for him to make the environment in which that person lived so toxic
mm-hmm.
that when he would identify a person as being a witch,
mm-hmm.
everybody would already accept it without interrogating or scrutinizing it.
Mm-hmm.
And he did a lot of the work for the Church of England in those days.
Mm.
And we felt that this was very similar, that Lord Harries's activity
mm.
was reminiscent of the activities of the Witchfinder General, in that he had denigrated the Hindu community to such a degree
mm.
that when the legislation entered the Parliament, the peers in the upper chamber didn't scrutinise.
Hmm.
They didn't. It didn't occur to them that actually if there are 480,000 people suffering, then it is 1-to-1.
Hmm.
Where is all the evidence for it? They didn't even look at the evidence.
Hmm.
On a wave of revulsion and self-righteous indignation,
mm-hmm.
they passed this through the upper chamber.
I see.
It went to the lower chamber.
Mm-hmm.
Now, interestingly enough, in the two-week period
mm-hmm.
between the two readings,
mm-hmm.
we managed to get our act together to some degree, the Hindu community, the Sikh community, we all came together, and we lobbied the lower chamber.
Mm-hmm.
And we informed the government that this is not real.
Mm-hmm.
The government, in fact, were very supportive.
This was the Cameron government.
This was the Cameron government,
mm.
yeah. And they scrutinized it, and I think they realized that, one, the evidence is flawed,
mm-hmm.
two, the impact, if you do an impact analysis on what this legislation will do,
mm-hmm.
that has been really inadequate,
mm-hmm.
in fact, non-existent, it hasn't been done. And we can see straight away that this is going to cause a problem. But most importantly, I think they realized also that introducing this would require probably another £20 million a year in terms of monitoring and recording and processing
mm-hmm.
this as a another protected characteristic.
Mm-hmm.
So the lower chamber mm-hmm. said no, and
I
they
see.
Threw it back to the upper chamber. We then lobbied the upper chamber and
mm-hmm.
educated many peers and told them what the background to this was. The first reading, I think it had passed by 113 votes.
Mm.
The second reading in the upper chamber, it passed by six or seven votes.
Oh, I see.
So many of the peers, many of the peers thought, actually,
mm.
maybe this isn't quite what we'd thought it was. But it did pass.
Mm-hmm.
And then it went down to the lower chamber. And in the lower chamber, a remarkable event occurred. And that was the Labour Party,
mm-hmm.
who have traditionally been very strongly supported by our communities.
Mm-hmm.
In my own family, we were always traditional Labour supporters. They called a three-line whip to pass this legislation.
I see.
Which basically is the strongest instruction to all of their MPs
mm-hmm.
to toe the party line.
Otherwise,
financial and other
mm.
penalties. So they called a three-line whip to ensure that this passed
mm.
in the lower chamber.
Mm.
And so it entered the statute books, but the government was very clear that this was, they felt, was flawed legislation
mm.
and that there had not been consultation prior to it.
Mm.
And so we were in conversations with them, and we presented our evidence to them. They accepted that this was going to be a miscarriage of justice.
Mm-hmm.
And for the first time, as far as I know, in history, they decided not to enact something that Parliament had legislated on.
So then what happens at that point? I mean, there's a law passed and the government says not worth enacting this one.
Yeah.
So do they have to go to the court to and get so clarification?
So this is, to some degree, this is grey territory. Mm-hmm. But the government's quite clear that a consultation mm-hmm. is the right thing to do.
Mm.
So David Cameron's government had announced that there mm-hmm. would be a consultation. Prime Minister May has also confirmed that a 12-week period of consultation is a necessary prerequisite mm-hmm. before enacting this legislation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so what we have done is gone back to basics, mm-hmm. done the research, mm-hmm. and as the National Council of Hindu Temples, mm-hmm. we have published our response mm-hmm. to this caste amendment. But our hope is actually that this will put into the Indian consciousness
mm-hmm.
the understanding that to be Indian is not to have a caste.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Our ancestors
yes.
were not prejudiced,
right.
and there were no Brahmin caste
correct.
Who said we're better than everybody else,
mm-hmm.
and you all have to be subservient to us,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and that the untouchables were not a feature mm-hmm. of a dharmic community.
Right.
They
right.
were a creation of a deliberate legal implement, and their suffering is horrific. When I think of the suffering that as a community they have been through and they have had to endure, if you add to it the notion that the people who were responsible
mm-hmm.
for their suffering
mm-hmm.
then convinced them that their suffering was actually due to the activities and beliefs of their own brethren, their
right.
own brothers, their own national brothers, their mm-hmm. own religious brothers,
mm-hmm.
it's an incredible story.
Yes. You know, just one observation on this point, and I have my old question that I need to revert back to
okay.
before I forget. One observation, if 2% of the population is contributing 6% GDP, I'm putting on my CEO hat, I'm pure commercial thing. I'm looking at it and say, this is an incredibly productive group of people, and I will try and recreate or create a situation where they can be even more productive, or they can see show their success to the other group, so everybody starts becoming more productive. And I would work towards making it even better for them.
Mm.
And it seems to me that by passing this legislation, you're actually taking two steps backwards, where you know you're kindling emotions in the hearts of people.
Yeah.
Some of them may have actually come here because they may have had faced some challenges in where they lived. And you're going back and say, here, relive those emotions again.
Now, that is exactly what is visible to any person using common sense.
Mm-hmm.
But in this scenario, there are tussles for power. Remember, we are in a country where there is a church established by law.
Mm-hmm.
And so, to a large degree, it is a theocracy.
Mm-hmm.
There are 26 lords who sit in the House of Lords.
Mm-hmm.
And they are all bishops.
I see.
Okay, so they scrutinize every piece of legislation that goes through.
Okay.
On the other side, we have then a civil government,
mm.
a democratically elected government,
right.
who are keen to see prosperity, harmony,
right.
community
right.
cohesion.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a tussle between the two of those. And I think this piece of legislation has really brought that out.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing that we discovered was that the religious institutions, the Abrahamic tradition, the Church of England, the Roman Catholic tradition,
mm-hmm.
not only did they want to introduce this caste legislation in this country,
mm-hmm.
but they were also lobbying for it to be introduced at European level.
I see.
At EU level, and lobbying for it to be introduced at the United Nations level.
Okay, so this okay. suddenly becomes a global problem from a pan-English problem to then becoming European.
Indeed. And who are on the receiving end of this vilification?
Mm-hmm.
A relatively passive,
mm-hmm.
harmless
right.
community, which mm-hmm. is, if there is a poster child
mm-hmm.
for community cohesion,
mm-hmm.
it has to be the Indian Hindu community.
Right.
Right. In every country, our contribution is pretty much the same.
Mm-hmm.
We're not troublemakers. We don't feature in the crime statistics to any great degree. We contribute very much so to the health and prosperity.
Mm-hmm.
And we participate fully in the educational, legal,
mm-hmm.
Financial parts of any community,
right,
of
right,
any society.
Right.
But there is a desire that we, and I've labeled it as Hindu odium, there are parties who actually benefit from seeing a weak Hindu community.
Hmm.
And especially a weak Indian community. One other thing that we discovered in our journey was that in India, if a person converts from a Hindu tradition, they lose their caste reservation status. And so this is a huge disincentive to those forces who are wanting to convert the heathen, you know, sort of who are still shouldering the white man's burden, as Kipling called it. This is a very big problem for them. And wouldn't it be wonderful if they could bring the world's government's attention to focus on this practice and convince the world that the Indian government is actually being discriminatory in that practice, and that if a person changes their religion because of caste problems, they should still be entitled to keep their reservation status.
Right, right.
We believe that is the true objective of this particular piece of legislation.
I see. And so it is law now, so it's up to the groups involved to make their case, and at the very minimum, I don't know, negate the law, or I mean, it has to go back again to in a way. Maybe the government has to take it up to the case of the courts and say this is economically unviable, and also it could be divisive to a section of the population which is very productive.
Yeah. Well, I approached Lambeth Palace, the office of the Archbishop of Canterbury, when all of this started, and made them aware that we are residents, we are British citizens, right? And this legislation puts us into a corner, into so many, in so many dimensions, and that when you corner a person and their survival and the future happiness of their children depends upon it, you have got a problem which will not go away. We tried to communicate with them that this was by very nature an unequal legislation. What this legislation says is it says that Indians do not have the right to be treated as equals. Yeah, they're saying, no, 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 we already know that some of you think you're better than the others and some of them are worse than the others, and so you don't have the right to be treated as equals. And that's done under the guise of equality legislation. It's saying that somebody born in a family with a name which is associated with a caste, then they are intrinsically inclined to think of themselves as superior. So you are denied the right to be equal by birth. It is another manifestation of that criminal by birth.
1870.
1871 revisited. It's exactly the same principle. And the interesting thing is in 1871, that legislation was introduced as a reform measure uplift the criminal tribes, educate and uplift them. That's how it was introduced. And in the same manner, we have the Church of England, a bishop from the Church of England, wanting to help the terrible British Hindu community with their nasty ancient habits, to uplift them out of ignorance. It's exactly the same profile.
So I want to go back to, in time, to the 1870s. So 1857, the country of England took over managing India.
From the East
after
India
the Sepoy
Company.
Rebellion. I don't want to call it mutiny, it's more like a rebellion.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Right? And it was a freedom struggle for the Indians to try and get independent of the British subjugation. Now, in 1870, the House of Lower House and the Upper House, they're sitting in England. And if my memory serves me correctly, at any point, there are only like 5,000 Britishers ruling India, or somewhere in that, thousands, not more than that.
Yeah.
And how would a member of the parliament, whether it's lower house or the upper house, know the nuances of what they were voting on?
They didn't need to. You see, it's quite striking in that they had a deemed superiority.
Right.
They were already taught by their church that they had the right of divine right to educate the heathen. And so all of their actions were beyond reproach. They were divinely sanctioned by the religious authorities to go out there and to change indigenous civilizations, to bring the light of wisdom to them. And there are many, many readings. If you read the readings of the religious establishment at that time, they are unbelievably prejudiced. In today's world, they contravene every single article of the human rights legislation.
Mm-hmm.
And they did it out of assumed superiority.
I see.
And in the report I quote several instances of the superiority which was intrinsic to their view of the world.
Mm-hmm.
In Shimla, they used to retire and unqualified people, administrators,
mm-hmm.
would make sweeping decisions which would influence the lives of tens of millions of people
hmm.
without any recourse to consultation, consideration, advice, study, none of it.
Mm.
They were just like emperors on the mount, just issuing edicts on the basis of prejudice and greed. And they didn't have to bear the karmic influences of that.
Mm.
But that is all coming out now. There is a history that's being revealed.
Mm.
And it's a very inconvenient history of what the British actually did at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all around us. I don't know whether you're aware of it, but another issue that we're working with is to do with British currency.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned the 1857 sepoy rebellion,
mm-hmm.
Mangal Pandey and
his
activities. That was in response to the presence of tallow
mm-hmm.
in gun cartridges.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, the new £5 note in this country
mm-hmm.
is plasticized,
mm-hmm.
and the manufacturing process uses tallow.
Mm.
And so we brought this to the attention of the Bank of England and said, this is not really a good thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And Winston Churchill's face features
mm-hmm.
on the £5 note.
Hmm.
All right, so now we have a piece of currency
mm-hmm.
which has got, in some circles, Churchill is referred to as the butcher of Bengal because of the
mm-hmm.
deliberate famine that he created
where
I think in the region of 4.5 million people died
mm-hmm.
as a result of him taking all of the food grain stocks away from that part of the world. So he's called the butcher of Bengal in many instances, and yet in Britain, he appears on a £5 note
mm-hmm.
as a folk hero in the British national identity. And so now, to add insult to injury, we have a £5 note which also contains tallow.
Mm.
And so there are lots of historical, unfortunate historical events which are all coming out into the fore. And they seem to be putting a lot of emphasis on the past misdemeanors
mm-hmm.
of the British Anglican adventurers who went out into the world.
Mm-hmm.
We're hoping to work with the British community to smooth, because we're British citizens, we
right,
want the well-being
right,
of this
right,
country.
Right.
But there are hurdles, some of which are to be laid at the door of the Church of England,
mm-hmm.
others to be laid at corporations,
mm-hmm.
but they are hurdles that need to be overcome if we're going to have really good, strong, genuine ties of friendship between
mm-hmm.
Indian citizens in India and Indian citizens here in Britain, and British citizens here as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts on this very significant piece of legislation, Hindu Odium, and I wish you all the best in your endeavor that the 2.6% of the Indian community here speaks together as one voice and make sure that some of the things that kind of divide them, they need to realize that that's really the intent and work towards being united. And I wish you all the best.
Shriji, thank you so much for coming all the way to our tiny little island in a cold corner of the Atlantic. And I would also just like to place on record our appreciation for the work that P Gurus has been doing.
Thank you.
It's wonderful to have a source of audited, quality, reliable news,
mm-hmm.
Especially when there is such a lot of noise in the background from the Indian media.
Right.
It's almost become a go-to portal for us to
mm-hmm.
to just check and get an update on what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
And we wish you every success and look forward to supporting your P Guru's endeavor so that it can bring even more solid, reliable information to all of us.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.